I would get home at, you know, 11:30, 12:30, nothing on TV. And I thought, I can't be the only person that comes home, you know, it's now 1 o'clock and there's nothing on TV. It's like bizarre. And I guess that was the inception of Chuck the Security Guard and the All Night Show.
Place. It hasn't changed in 25 years or thereabouts. Ryerson, how are you?
I'm really well, Chuck.
You're looking good. Chaz.
Oh, sorry. I'm feeling great.
You're looking fabulous. And Leonard's here. Leonard, how are you?
Good to see you, Chaz.
Yeah, good to see you again. So, guys, we've got some tape to show, surely.
Leonard's put some amazing clippage together.
Well, let's have a look at that.
Okay,
here you go.
This is exciting. This is exciting. Oh, my goodness. 25 years. All right, that button pops that up, as I remember. This is surely an antique, do you think?
It's 42 years old.
Yeah, well, there you go, antique-y time. Let's see, one, two, I'm going to try. That's the one that works it. Here we go. Have a look at this.
Every night we'd sit down and we'd spend the evening with Chuck. We'd talk to Chuck, though he couldn't hear us and he rarely answered, but he was a part of our lives. The All Night Show, for that very brief period of time, was a part of our family.
I remember the first night that I actually saw the show. I didn't know what to think. I suppose the premise came across pretty fast. The folks at the studio have all gone home. Who's left in the wee hours, but, oh, the security guard. Except the security guard looked like no security guard I ever saw. I mean, all of a sudden there's this kind of winsome, bookish fellow saying, hey, you.
It seemed normal. Whatever I was watching was a normal thing. And then on came the security guard who said, well, what am I going to play now? And I suddenly realized, okay, this is either a joke or the inmates had taken over the asylum.
You could smell that it was something brand new, never done before. The all-night television show brought television into the hands of the masses.
Okay, you phone in with your answers, and you tell me. Just keeping you on your toes.
We wanted something a little bit different. We wanted something crazy. And there it was, on our screen, late at night, when we were up. It was perfect for us.
My listeners were calling me up and asking me if I had heard about the All Night Show. And I realized they were doing this sort of in tandem media consumption where they were watching television, the All Night Show, and yet they'd keep the radio station on, CFMT-TV, during the night. So that's how I first heard about it.
The All Night Show did not feel like normal television of the period because it had thrown that rule book out. They zigged when everybody else zagged.
Chuck and Ryerson are part of the tradition, the Friday night monster horror chiller TV host. They would host horror movies and maybe a Buck Rogers serial and so forth. And there was always this character, and it was like, hey, it's our little club. Everyone else has gone to bed.
I had been running a movie theater with my partner Gary Topp, the 99 Cent Roxy. And so I started my quest for an answer to all night television. So there weren't a lot of people that I ran into who had the same desire that I did to be up past 1 o'clock, but there were some. And Michael Lennick, Errol Bruce were certainly two in the forefront because they were out there knocking on doors, asking the same questions I was asking. Why not all night television? Why not something in the middle of the night? Why not something better than just an old movie? And they were getting the same answers that I was getting.
I think it was Jeff Silverman who came up with a security guard and suggested that Michael and I wander down to Yuck Yucks and have a look at one of the comics that was working there named Chas Lawther.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Chas Lawther. It's very nice to be here tonight.
So we did, and he was droll and dry, and I think afterward Michael and I said, yeah, we could picture him in a security guard uniform, and he would probably be just the guy to do it.
The security guard was not Jeff's first idea. Jeff's first idea, as I recall, was kind of something of a pajama party. I think he originally wanted the host to be in a bunny suit.
I seem to remember there was a guy in pajamas at one point, a guy in a bunny suit, but that may be just a bad memory that's filtered in from somewhere else. But once we kind of narrowed it down, the idea of a security guard seemed to take shape.
I want to give Rob and Bruce, security guards down at the TD Center, a big security guard salute. Hey, you!
You felt like you had your own security guard standing at the foot of your bed. You know, if I wanted to hire a video guard to stand in my room to watch me go to sleep, Chuck would be the man.
Actually, I think the idea of a guy who is really nice and safe and secure evolved, because when we made the pilot originally, the character was much more hyper, very hyper individual, and because there was a lot of discussion about whether you needed someone like that to keep people awake during the night.
Hi, my name's Chuck, I'm the security guard, and welcome to my TV show, All Night TV, 6 hours of me and, well, all these tapes, all sorts of tapes. I got these incredible tapes that I found in the basement here at the TV station, and I'm going to show them all. Old TV, oh, I love TV, you'll love it too, I got all sorts of things. Well,
and then, of course, as soon as we started doing it, you realized, no, that wasn't the guy at all. What you wanted really was just an easygoing security guard, a blanket.
And welcome to Wednesday night's version of the All Night Show. Of course, tonight is science fiction night, science fiction oriented anyway. So we have the Outer Limits on, and then we have...
But he was just so accessible, so likable, and so endearing that how could you not like him? And that fallibility of that character, the fact that he didn't know what he was doing, that he wasn't a slick broadcast kind of guy, that the antithesis, really, that just added to the appeal. And again, he was one of us.
Are there any security guards out there watching tonight?
Well, I bet there's one or two.
Well, I bet there's one or two. Well, maybe you shouldn't be, but if you are, I'm happy you are, because, hey, I'm talking to you. But I want to give you hints. This is hints for security guards. Coming up with me there, Ryerson?
Yeah, I'm right with you.
Good. Okay, hints for security guards. This is hint number three. This is something I always keep in mind. Never wear a real tie. Wear a breakaway tie like that, see? So if you get grabbed around the neck, you can get rid of it. Anyway.
The lovely thing about Chas as Chuck the security guard was he had this naivete. He was an innocent. He was a stranger in a strange land of television.
Chas had an ability to connect with an audience that I don't think any of us fully understood at the time and perhaps still haven't quite figured out. He was such a gentle soul.
I would imagine a good 65% of the audience really thought that he was actually a security guard, and he played that just so perfectly.
If there was anything stagey about his performance, the basic premise would have fallen apart. You had to believe that he was just some security guard who thought, well, nobody else is watching. I'll just twiddle these knobs and do this and do that and play what I want to play. And that spirit and that energy informed the whole show.
So why don't we...
Oh, do you want to put the phone number up?
Oh, yeah, let's put the phone number up. I always think, why should I put it up? Because there's so many people on there. But heck, if they weren't on there, they wouldn't be on there if they didn't know how to phone.
That's right.
Okay, well, we'll leave that up there, and let's talk to someone. Hello.
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 Hello, I can't hear you at all.
Can you not hear me at all?
No, I can't. Okay, good. Well, you know what? That's really, I think, all I need to know.
Okay.
Because I've got this, I've got some unfinished business here, which I have really wanted to deal with. So let me get to that now.
Wait a minute.
What?
We've got commercial to do. We've got to take a break. Here, commercials.
Okay. All righty. Still commercials.
Gotta make money.
Here we go.
If you enjoyed Men into Space, I think you'll like next week's show. The next time you smoke Luckies. Remember how great cigarettes used to taste? Luckies still do.
Me. Hello. Ryerson?
Yes,
Ryerson, I told you. Come on, it's time.
Sorry.
Come on.
Are we on already?
Yeah.
Are you sure you know how to do it?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
You're gonna... Oh, there you go.
Is it working?
Oh, yes, it is. I can see you.
Can you?
Oh.
Oh, yeah. It's working. Oh. Here, let me sit down.
Oh, this feels good.
Huh? There we go.
Zoom. Oh, this is a zoom. Oh, there we go.
Have you got it?
Got it.
Hi. My name's Chuck. I'm the security guard here at MTV. Well, I guess I'm more than that now. I'm the host of the All Night Show. Hey, welcome to the All Night Show. My show runs all night, runs till 6 in the morning, starts now. And I'm going to be here all night, and I hope you are, too. I should introduce you to my friend, Ryerson. Ryerson, say hello.
Oh, hello, everybody. My name's Ryerson Dupont. I'd like to say hello to my mother and dad in Peterborough and to Craig and Wendy, whose 10th month anniversary is tonight.
That's enough, Ryerson. I'm the host. You're the cameraman. Sorry. I do the talking. You just fill in bits when I stop.
Right.
Okay, well...
Ernie Kovacs was an inspiration. Saturday Night Live was an inspiration. Reiner Schwartz's show on TV Ontario, a show called Night Music, which was really radio on television, was an inspiration for us. And we were basically trying to carry on from there.
We did 300 shows, 300 plus night music shows. So we're talking about 300 hours of live television in 2.5 seasons.
Television as something that you lived with was just starting to get into the popular consciousness. And there's a great energy to that. There's something really wonderful about watching something that feels like improv. This show was clearly thought out, but it had the feeling that you were watching something spontaneous. So in a way, the show was anti-television.
Ryerson Dupont grew out of the need for someone that Chuck the security guard could bounce off of.
I saw a great piece of graffiti somewhere today. Where did I see it? I think, and it said Chuck lives. It was great, and I thought,
I'm reassured.
It was Che Guevara. Yeah.
That's a reassuring sign.
Errol played that guy so perfectly. It was just that fine line of being a little bit thick, not real thick, and you just want him to stop talking now, and that'll be enough.
Mm. Listen, when they send those videotapes in, you know, they could send them on Betamax or VHS.
Or 16mm or 8mm, Super 8.
Mm-hmm.
You send it in, we'll play it for you. Well, we'll have to look at it first.
When you boil down the DNA of these shows like Prisoners of Gravity or Night Music or The All Night Show, I think you have to come to a certain point, which is pirate radio.
There are some interesting parallels between The All Night Show and something that I did in the mid-60s. I ended up working for a pirate radio station, Radio Caroline, as a disc jockey.
Radio Caroline is legendary among, I think, both the music and the radio industries. There were no radio stations in England that would play the popular music of the day. So what a very enterprising group of people decided to do was to take a ship, park it halfway between England and Europe in the middle of the English Channel on international waters, and they broadcast all the great music of the day. They were one of the hottest radio stations in the world, with millions of listeners able to tune them in.
We heard about Caroline and the other pirate stations and the people who were rolling around in trucks with transmitters and airplanes and God knows what to avoid the law and to broadcast freely.
So that when we came to do the Old Night Show, there was that kind of feel to it, that we were half a dozen or so loons doing outrageous things that most television stations wouldn't have allowed it in their front door, let alone in front of a camera.
Hey, you! The Rampage. All right, so now Ryerson and I have something very special planned for you. We thought you'd we'd take you down to the president's office. Come on, let's go. Follow me.
I was the security guard of the building, so I could go anywhere I wanted. I knew we went into the basement, we went up and down elevators. To have free rein and be able to go anywhere in that television studio was remarkable.
The show felt chaotic. I'm sure that behind the scenes it wasn't that crazy. It couldn't have been that crazy. But the feeling that a viewer had was, okay, this is going out of control. These guys are making this up as they go along. You know, they're knitting their parachute as they fall.
Well, this is it.
Of course, the place was deserted, and it was a very strange atmosphere. We had the run of the whole building. We could go anywhere. In fact, I think at one point we even did go into the Danny Annuzzi, bless his cotton socks, his office.
You know. Are you watching, Mr. Annuzzi?
Oh, Chuck.
Yeah, this is pretty
comfy. Oh. We shouldn't do that.
Yeah, he's fired!
We were kids in this enormous sandbox. We had a television station to ourselves. And we figured if a dozen people were watching, we were in pretty good shape because there were 12 other people out there who had a similar sensibility to what we were doing, and perhaps it would grow from there.
There was a sense of family, a sense of community that happened at night. And I think that's what we tapped into. And so to be live and be up with the people who were living those lives and living the nightlife was crucial to the success of the show.
You know, if you're staying up late, of course, now it's 4:30, and I mean, we dropped off the people who go to sleep at 2:30, you know, just got to get up early. You're hardcore night people right now.
We found an audience that broke into three segments, which was fascinating to me. There was an early audience of just sort of stoners. So they wanted to see music videos and weird stuff. And then there'd be a middle ground that would straddle from, like, you know, 1 o'clock to 3 or 4 o'clock. And those were shift workers and doctors and nursing mothers, hundreds of thousands of people who make their living after people go to sleep. And then geriatrics would wake up. I guess as you get very old, I guess I'll find out soon, you wake up much earlier. So we would show, you know, Passing Parade and old jazz shorts, and they would love it. And so by catering to these three different audiences that no one beforehand even thought existed, the show made, it made its name and it made, became a part of history.
Hey, come on, everybody. Let's exercise.
John Lennon used to refer to himself and his three partners as the only four people on Earth who never saw the Beatles. We were the four guys, me, Chas, Errol, and Jeff, who never actually saw the All Night Show.
We were pretty much out of touch with a lot of people a lot of the time, a lot of our friends. You know, we were just either sleeping or working on TV. So we didn't know what was happening, how it was being accepted out there.
It was very contained. We were in that little control room without any real idea of the impact of it. And it was only after the people started coming up to me, hey, you're the guy in the, hey, you're Chuck, hey, you're that guy, I know you. And that was just within 2 weeks. It went from 0 to 100. It was that fast.
And we were getting complaints from the station because the old guy who ran the mail room was hurting his back, schlepping the bags of mail up the stairs to us every day, and he was getting pretty peeved about that.
And then the people started showing up at the station's back door when we were leaving the station at 6-7 o'clock in the morning. And being Ryerson the cameraman, who was often heard and never seen, it didn't affect me as much as it did Chas. But Chas couldn't go anywhere.
He would just go out to buy a quart of milk, and suddenly he'd be surrounded by people hey-you-ing him.
The second week of the show, he came in and said, I have to come here, you have to send me here by taxi. I cannot take the subway, I can't walk down the street, people are stopping me, it takes 3 hours to get to work.
And Chaz's personality then wasn't all that accepting of adoration and fame and adulation. He found it very difficult to handle. It scared him.
Well, there was a dark side to fame, especially the flash mob variety that Chas was suddenly experiencing. And then something truly nightmarish happened, and we all got to witness that dark side as it turned to pure evil.
Some guy, amateur photographer, who's a Lennon fan and waited outside his place for pictures.
The impact of it was tremendous the night before on December the 8th, and then we went to air on December the 9th.
We were all so shattered by this event that the last thing we wanted to do was a television show.
Michael, of course, was just rounding up as much information as he could get, and Jeff was out scouring the banks to find any kind of, as I remember, any kind of footage we could find on Lennon.
It was remarkable. It was 9:30, 10 o'clock in the morning, and everybody was in. And it took us a while to figure out what we were going to do that night. I mean, it was like being punched in the solar plexus and not being able to catch your creative breath. We opened up the phone lines and we talked to people about John Lennon, and we played Lennon music and we played Lennon video.
And I seem to remember that we had tributes, and we certainly answered the phone a lot that night. And I remember an aspect of the whole thing feeling like we were a psychiatrist's couch in a way.
I said, I'm 29 now, so I grew up with the Beatles.
Oh yeah, of course you did. Of course you did. Yeah, me too. Me too.
Nine?
Hmm?
You're 29?
No, I'm a bit older than that, but...
And after a couple of hours of this, our producer Jeff felt that you could be sad everywhere. Why don't we present the one alternative? Why don't we be someplace that sad viewers could tune into that wasn't going to just depress them further? Basically, Jeff was saying, would you please run a car 54? Where are you? Call a phone booth, do something.
When I was a kid in Brooklyn, I used to listen to the radio at night, and it used to fascinate me to hear people call in from all over the United States with their story, whatever it happened to be. And so again, in an effort to try and figure out how do you fill time in the middle of the night, I thought, you know what would be great? Call phone booths all around the world. Let them ring. If somebody answers, that's got to be interesting.
Okay. I've got a couple of phone numbers in Australia to Melbourne, Australia. And these are phone numbers of phone booths in the city of Melbourne. Now, I don't know. I don't know Melbourne. Do you know Melbourne?
No.
Like I know Melbourne?
It's down under. Sport.
Down under. Okay, so let's dial this and see what we get.
Of course, December the 8th, it was the middle of their summer. And this guy answered, and, you know, we slid into the conversation about, you know, what's the impact of John Lennon's death down there.
Well, I don't think newspapers would have sold so many copies since Nixon resigning. That would be the most recent calamity of such proportions. It's just myself, though. I think he was anybody that professes to be more popular than Jesus Christ deserves to be shot. So that's my attitude towards him.
And I remember looking at Ryerson just like, and at the camera too, and the people who were watching. I think after we poured our souls out for 2 or 3 hours, and I don't remember hanging up on him, but I think I cut him off.
Really? Well, it's been quite nice talking to you, and take care, have a good time, bye. I mean, please don't do that.
And we threw to something else and went on from there. And now, 25 years later, I can tell you that Australia phone call provided a punchline for that evening that we desperately needed. It was great TV.
Many people say that's the night that the show came of age. I don't know. To me, it was just another in the pantheon of weird and wonderful things you could see when you turned on the All Night Show. But, you know, there was something that no one's done since, and that's reach out and talk to people, unsuspecting people, unset up people. And I still think there's a show in there somewhere.
Ever since I came to this country, I have been waiting for all-night television. It's here at last. My children are happy.
Hey, welcome to the people who were watching Casablanca earlier on. Nice to have you with us here at the All-Night Show. Let me put this back in the box. Now, I want to tell you something, that Ryerson and I are going to be having contests of all kinds here, which you can contact us here at the station. I'll give you a phone number in a minute. We're going to be having some contests, and I want to start you off on a contest right now. This is the Igor Guzenko look-alike contest. And if you send in pictures to the station, we'll judge them, and the person who looks most like Igor Guzenko will get, well, we'll decide on a prize.
Well, there we go. Now, I know that many of you think that it was Ryerson and I who made the whole show. And of course, I don't mind you thinking that, but the truth is, that isn't the truth. Of course, there were many, many people who put the show together night after night. And I think it would be time to meet some of them. So I know Leonard has put together part of his documentary on this tape. And here's some of the people who helped make the show possible. Really, Ryerson and I had a very small part in all of it. We were just the front guys.
A lot of hard work going on behind the scenes on that program.
I remember a contest winner saying, who are all these people? Because they really believed the illusion of Chuck playing the tapes, and they didn't know there was a whole infrastructure in behind making it happen, which was really pretty cool.
For the All Night Show, mostly did VTR. So I was, you know, loading up the films, loading up the tape inserts and stuff.
There were actually about a dozen of us all hiding from the sun and making late night TV. Bob Schroeder and Lee Wilson were our segment directors, and Lee also did weird stuff like the All Night t-shirt commercials. Rob Meckler helped with all our studio stuff, as did J.P. Edwards. One of the truly unsung heroes of the show was Michelle Lee, Jeff Silverman's wife, who came in and taught herself videotape editing, probably so she could keep an eye on her man. But Michelle became a truly great editor. She created our opening montage and all kinds of neat shorts and trailers, and was as responsible as any of us for the overall look and feel of the show. We all wore many hats on the program, but I think the most hatted was Michael Lennick. Who was not only Leonard, the alternate co-host, but he was also the sound man and directed the program from the sound booth immediately next to the control room that we used to do the All Night Show out of. Not only did he wear those hats, but he also wrote a lot of the stuff for the show, a lot of the bits, created a lot of the bits.
I guess the way it worked is I would book these things to be run on the air. And then Michael and Chas and Errol would come in, and we'd do a rundown of what we had. And based upon on what we were showing, they would figure out, well, what can we do?
It was a different energy overnight. Like, there wasn't the stresses of the day shift.
As I think back of the All Night Show, I can think of two people who were unsung heroes. That's Claire Lemieux and Bob LaMarche, who got married, and now it's Claire and Bob LaMarche.
They came as a team, they came as a couple, and they're still together, of course, and that was it. You know, Bob and Claire are taking care of things.
We found out that the All Night Show might be coming in, and we were pissed off because we might have to work overnights.
You know what? He's probably right.
Their whole focus was technical, and it felt like they provided this big, soft, warm, technical playground for us.
Claire Lemieux LaMarche, what a sweet heart, what a patient, gentle being she was.
She was the person who made sure that the show ran on time.
Sitting there with watches going crazy.
Probably the only person I've ever met to this day who can count forward and backward and talk to you at the same time. I mean, she'd be going, you know, 20 seconds to the floor, 9, 8, 7.
It seemed pretty easy. I could count backwards. It was okay.
She was so calm. We would, our live segments would run way over. We'd say, sorry, Claire, and she'd say, it's okay, guys, I'll fix it.
You know, there were times when things would break down, a clip wouldn't work.
But right now, I want to show you something special. It's going to be a surprise.
It's all right, Chuck. You can take your time.
I can take my time.
You sure?
All right.
Chuck, we're going to have to come back to you now. I'm going to try and get things fixed here, and I'll let you know when it is. So if you could just take care of it, so we'd come back and I'd be pressing, oh, well, we got something wrong with the machine here. I'll see what I can fix.
We're just getting the hang of the machinery around here.
Film would break, for instance, and they would need a few minutes up in Master Control to stick the film back together again. So they would come back down to us live, and we would start up tight on a pile of videotape on the control room floor, and I'd slowly pull back to reveal...
Ryerson? Yes? Ryerson? Yes? Well, there you are! Will he or won't he find the button?
And eventually I would hand him another cassette back, which he would pop back into the machine, and magically he would push the button and we'd pick right up where the film broke upstairs in Master Control.
Okay, let me press the button, you watch this. I'm gonna have a little more tea, because I think that's what I need.
Well, a nice bunch of people, eh?
Aren't they wonderful?
You know, just so much fun to work with all the people who worked on the show. It was just such a great time. And you know, beyond the people who worked on the show, I have to say that I think the main thing about doing the show was that we felt we were such a part of a much larger community, because of course the phones were working and people could phone in, and it was just like, it felt like a large family.
I loved the people who phoned in their parts when we were playing guitar.
Well, you know, I just happened to have my guitar here, and I was thinking for old times' sake.
Yeah, there's a wee bit of a problem.
What?
The time, right now, commercial roll, please.
Okay, see, I feel like we're just really, shills is the word? surely not, that would
well,
be...
Well, listen, television is not about the programming, it's all about the commercials.
Is that right?
Aye.
Is that right? Well, that's really something I should learn that.
My old grandfather used to tell me that.
I'm learning it now. Here's some commercials.
We're the Merry Texaco men. Tonight we may be showmen. Tomorrow we'll be servicing your cars.
We showed some of the most amazing stuff. And where else could you see this sort of thing? I mean, nowhere else on TV, and the only movie theaters that were still running shorts and independent films were the ones that Jeff ran before he started the all-night show with Michael and me. So I think we may have served the common good right there, even if all we did was provide a home for rarely seen gems like Bambi Meets Godzilla.
That's great. Oh, that's great. You know, when we were doing the show, people would send in all sorts of stuff that they'd made, shorts and cartoons and whatnot. And that was the great thing about the show, was that we had the opportunity to introduce an audience to all that kind of stuff. So here's something along that line. Have a look at this.
And after that you can depend.
Jeff was a brilliant programmer. I think he was remarkable at that. I think he had an incredible vision. And you know, Jeff, I'm sure, will tell you that, well, it was just stuff I liked. That was, you know, it was just, if it was okay, it was interesting to me, that was what I wanted to put on television. But I think he was a real gift as a programmer.
We had like 6 hours to fill. So we had to find material that we could get for nothing or next to nothing. We had a person working on the show named Eva Vago. We would give her instructions as we would leave in the morning. Call all the hospitals, see if we can get footage of operations. She played me back messages of people who said, you're out of your mind. People are gonna see someone taking out their kidney and take out their kidney. We can't give you that. Of course, today, you know, it runs on A&E and the Discovery Channel and you can watch all you want. But in those days, no such thing. One time we showed a film of a guy blowing himself up.
Hello, my name is Dave Chisholm. I've always wanted to make a movie. This will be my first and last effort. I hope you like it. I've decided to film my last act, one which most of you have contemplated at one time or another in your life, suicide.
We didn't know whether this was real or not. We stared at it, we ran it back and forth. I had a background in visual effects and was quite convinced that this was very, very clever trickery, which is what it turned out to be. The fellow actually did a very cathartic thing. He worked out his demons in the course of making this film, and he was still very much around. He just didn't want to talk to anybody, so we never got him on the air for an interview.
Wouldn't you know that I got that call at like 10 o'clock in the morning, that the RCMP was there, and they were saying that I was going to be charged as an accomplice to a murder.
SHD, or spontaneous human detonation, has no cure. Sufferers live in constant fear.
We took so much flack over that stupid, brilliant little short that we eventually decided to prove it was a fake by doing our own version, which we disguised as a public service announcement. And that was great fun for me, because I got to blow up Errol.
Sending your research dollars to Charities Against Social Hazards, Post Office Box 1945, Los Alamos, New Mexico.
Well, a lot of local actors and comics helped us out with segments and characters and odd little bits. More than a few of them were just starting out themselves.
You know, I think it's a really good idea. I'm up really late. Like, I can't get to sleep so well anymore, so I think it's a really good idea because I'm up really late. And, like, I like to watch something on television besides, like, the test pattern because I'm up really late. So I think it's a really good idea on night television in Toronto.
A lot of people came from Yuck Yucks. And two of those people were Jim Carrey and Maurice LaMarche. And Maurice LaMarche was a really great impressionist.
Maurice LaMarche, what a talent. And the characters and the voices that he did, combined with those great old black and white pictures that we had.
I'd never seen it before. I've certainly seen it many times since, where we do a lip wipe. And so you have a picture, and then you wipe out the lips with the camera, and you put somebody else's lips in, and we would put Maurice's lips in.
Hey, yo, you stay cool.
And when Maurice LaMarche went off to, you know, become famous in Hollywood as a guy who works all the time in voice, Jim Carrey was coming up. And Jim was a great impressionist. So some of the lips that you saw on the show were Jim Carrey's lips. That's how he got into comedy, by doing impressions. And we caught a lot of them on the All Night Show.
All Night Television, thank goodness you're here. It gives me a chance to do something now besides chase after women.
Whatever happened to that Jim Carrey guy?
Well, you know what struck me about watching that, Ryerson?
What's that, Chas?
Is that you're the only one of all of us who haven't aged a day.
It's the facelifts, the money that I got from my inheritance.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You think that does it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, being Lord Ryerson of DuPont brings with it buckets of money and a castle.
Lord Ryerson?
Lord Ryerson of DuPont.
How did that happen?
26 cousins had to die before the title fell to me, and they all did.
And all naturally.
Well, most of them.
Yeah, good, good. Okay, well, enough of that for now. Look, I've got some, what?
Business.
What kind of business?
Commercials.
Okay.
We still have to do that stuff.
We don't. I guess the station does. Okay, and then we'll get on to the business. Here we go. And.
Tuesday Jack,
bum, bum, the foaming cleanser.
Well, anyway, we've got Felix the Cat coming up for you very shortly, but I brought Ryerson here, you know, and we like to play music sometimes. There's his hands. So we thought we would play some music for you because people had said, why don't you play some more music? So we're going to play some more music. Ryerson, begin. That's a bit faster than that. I'll catch you on the change.
There's an interesting duality about the show. On the one hand, there was this incredible sense of freedom that we could do absolutely everything. And on the other hand, there was a sense of, oh, geez, what are we going to do? We got to fill 5 minutes. What are we going to come up with? I just can't think of another thing. You know what? I'm just going to sit and look at the camera. We'll do 2 minutes where I'll just sit and stare at the camera, and we'll see what that'll do. And we did.
First get a little bit near spurt like a bit near tat, a spurt like a bit near. A spurt like a best spurt like a bit near to burt like a bit yet.
You had to fill the time, so you had to keep coming up with stuff. But I'm sure somewhere amongst what's left of the show are some really banal moments where you go, what on earth were they thinking?
We came up with an idea. We painted this elevator, which exists to this day. Called Elevator to the Stars. And we would say to a band or a group or a ventriloquist or somebody who had an act, we're going to send you up from the basement, and then you have 3 minutes. At the end of the 3 minutes, if you're not done with your song, your act, or whatever it is, the doors are going to close and you're going to go down. So I'd advise you to sort of be bowing.
We had some great people come and work with us on the Old Night Show at various points during this year's run. One of the stranger guys was Paul Del Stud. He was a strange man.
If your goldfish seems listless, put a pinch of soda in the bowl.
The late night philosophy of Paul Del Stud, which certainly we here on the All Night Show follow.
We were always looking for characters, and you know, as much as we went out and looked for them, they came looking for us. We found this guy who, I don't remember where I bumped into him, he bumped into me, but he was known to the public at that time as Paul Del Stud. He had this character. So we took a bunch of books on household hints and we gave it to him. We said, read one of them.
As a remedy for prickly heat, add a little baking soda to the water when bathing baby during the hot summer months.
And he became one of the stars of the show. People loved him popping up before a commercial or in between a movie and a short, saying something so inane. And yet it had some basis in reality.
When boiling fish, always use a sticky evaporated pan.
Out of that context, it would have just, you know, like, what is this? But within the context, and given what the show is about, and the sensibility, and let's face it, the sensibilities of most of the people watching it at the time, which were somewhat altered, it was all great, wonderful stuff.
And he was a happy man. He was a happy man while the show lasted. I've bumped into him several times since, and he wishes he could be Paul Del Stud again, and you know what, so do I.
To remove dog hairs from unupholstered furniture, wipe the furniture with a dampened chamois.
Okay, well that's great. Let's get this out of here. Now, I've got this business here I want to finish
talking of business.
What's this?
Commercials.
More commercials?
Well,
seems to me that, this is a blurry memory, but it seems to me we alienated a lot of our sponsors at the time.
Well, yes, we did. And curiously enough, that tape there is the one with the alienated sponsors on it.
This I'd like to see. Okay. Alienated sponsors.
Yes.
When we went on the air, I believe we sold for something like $35 a spot. And when we got off the air, it was in the hundreds of dollars a spot. But we had our problems with sponsors.
You enjoying your tea, Ryerson?
Oh, and the donut. Hunt's Donuts are really nice.
Hunt's Donuts, they certainly are.
Chas just hated shilling, which was understandable given the reality that we were trying to maintain. But the show was starting to take off and Jeff and his partners were out there making deals. So the pressure was on him pretty hard.
Okay,
Phil Silver's time.
And it finally came to a head over this incredibly lame little fur ball called a minky. You stuck your hand up its tush and worked it like a ventriloquist dummy, or at least you were supposed to. And that's where Chas drew the line. So he basically spent that Saturday night with this dead-looking creature wrapped around his neck and never referred to it, not even once.
I think we lost sponsors that actually Jeff had suggested and that I just dug my heels in and said, no, I could never do that. And of course, in retrospect, I think, I was crazy. Of course, I should have been advertising my ass off. Anything at all, bring it on. You know, the keeping true to the character. My goodness, what was I thinking?
We would kid around about the sponsors and about the product, and I don't think it was derogatory towards them. It was just having fun with them. And, you know, I think it lent credibility to the show, because if somebody invented a mousetrap and it didn't work, well, is that our fault? I think they should make one that works.
You know, I think that get 'em mousetrap was one of the sponsors we lost.
Well, I wonder why, but it was really tasty blue screen, wasn't it?
It was very nice, very nice.
And you know, Leonard has put together a whole bunch of the blue screens that we did 25 years ago.
Well, I would be interested in seeing those.
Me too.
Let's have a look. Ah. Here we go.
Hey, you!
The blue screen bits were all done live right in that control room switcher. It was way more than a prop.
I was just having a little snooze there.
Every Saturday, Rob Meckler had a standing order to put up this massive blue screen, which was really hard work, so we'd feel obliged to come up with something, usually at the last moment.
New York. New York.
Come in, please. And sit down, sir.
Well, it's really wonderful actually having you both be here, and I do hope that you get out and see Joined at the Hip, because I'm sure it's really a good show.
I bet you talk more
in the show than you do here, right? Since working with Suzette, my mouth muscles have just stopped.
Okay, well, listen.
Hey, and watch Raleigh's ramblings now. Yes, I think I'll go back in the box, and I think I'll watch Car 54 from down here.
Well, that makes me feel good about the old show. It was all by the seat of our pants and done live.
And it was amazing what we did with the technology as it existed 25 years ago.
Well, I guess that's right, Ryerson. Boy. Okay, here. So now I've got
what
some.
We could do with no.
What?
Can it take care of that kind of business? Commercial reel, please. The real commercials. But, hey, it's
I'm sure they're really good products.
Yeah.
There we go.
If you've held back till now, join in around the piano as our lovely guest, Francis Osborne, leads us in The Ride of the Valkyrie by the late, great Dick Wagner.
You know, I have to say that as much as I loved doing the show, and there was so much about it that I loved doing, well, all of it I loved doing, and every night was just a gas, but Thursday night, which was the night we had musicians on, oh, that was so great, and we had so many great musicians on who would just drop by and play with me. You're going to play with me?
James Cotton told you played like...
He told me I played exactly like Muddy Waters, and 16 years after the fact, I realized he meant I actually played slide guitar, not that I sounded anything like Muddy Waters at all, but it was a compliment that I can still savor. Anyway, I know you've got a tape, and I'm guessing you put it in already.
I did already.
Because that would shorten up time. Okay, so that's good, so why don't we play that? Here's the musicians.
One of the great things about doing the All Night Show was that we went way past when the bars closed, and there was some great musicians playing in bars around the city. And not just local musicians, of which there were many, but big names who came in. James Cotton of the James Cotton Blues Band came in and jammed with Chuck and Ryerson.
Loved it. I loved being able to play guitar with all these wonderful musicians who came in. You know, David Wilcox and Dominic Troiano and Mary Margaret O'Hara and King Biscuit Boy. If I started to single out the musicians who came in, then I would have to mention everyone. Eva Everything came on, and I actually remember being a little frightened of her because she was so weird when she first came on. But of course, she actually turned out to be rather a normal person, which maybe she wouldn't want to know.
There was basically no outlet for music videos. You couldn't get airplay for them. You make me feel like watching TV. The All Night Show was like the very, very first show that you could play a music video on. So that was fantastic for us, particularly independent artists, because we started doing it before the majors did in any big way. What do you want most in your life?
What do you need to see you through? Well, it was early summer 1981, and my band Twitch had just released our first album, Twitch and Shout, and we thought maybe there'd be a good place we could play on, maybe do some promotion. It was wonderful. I remember just before we went on air, the camera's ready to go, and he's about counting us in, and all of a sudden, Chuck turns to me and says, "Are you okay with this?" Which I thought was the timing was just perfect. On many occasions for the next few weeks, I'd be getting onto the streetcar, the Queen car, heading downtown, and invariably somebody'd holler, "Hey, Garwood, hey, how's Chuck? How's Chuck and Ryerson?" It was always late night, and it was always the denizens of the darkness, and everyone seemed to really love that program.
Almost inevitably, the players, the musicians, the actors, whoever was in town with a show to put on the stage would find their way into the all-night television studios later that night after their show. I particularly remember a great, great live in-studio performance done by Richie Havens. Took your breath away.
Richie Havens is here in our little control room on this little UHF-TV station in Toronto. You know, it was just phenomenal.
So in the history of the All Night Show, the name that stands out above all is Dan Yannuzzi. I mean, I don't know what his reasons were, and I guess I never will, why he would do this. But Dan Yannuzzi, who was at that time running Channel 47, owned it, I believe, he just got it. I mean, he never struck me as someone who stayed up late at night or all night, because he was always there early in the morning. But he got it and said, "Hey, this is what you have to work with. Here are your boundaries. Here's the amount of money you have to spend. Go, do." And I'd never had such freedom in my life. And I think the fact that all of us who worked on the show had that kind of freedom allowed us to do things that most stations wouldn't even attempt.
Have you heard about the all-night show treasure hunt? Every night on the all-night show on MTV, Chuck the security guard gives away a clue. Each clue brings you closer to the hidden treasure.
Jeff Silverman always came up with the strangest things. And one of the stranger ones was a treasure hunt. And we're going to bury treasure down at the beach.
Here, mates, I'm getting close to that treasure. I know it's out there somewhere, and I've been following the clues. And it's led me to a beach, but I don't know which beach the treasure's under.
Radio receivers and speakers and turntables and whatever Jeff could come up with for prizes, we were going to take, and we're going to bury them. Well, we eventually managed to talk him out of burying electronics. A, it wasn't good for the electronics, and B, it took up a lot of, you had to dig big holes.
Treasure tokens, where are the treasure tokens?
I got a call just before the show went off the air. How they got me in the control room, I don't know, but it was like some official who said, if you don't put a stop to this contest immediately, we're suing you and the station. I didn't know what he was talking about, and he told me it was people digging up Cherry Beach, which is where we buried the treasure tokens. I guess what we forgot to find out was that Cherry Beach was a man-made beach, and about a foot or two underneath the sand was cement. That didn't stop treasure token hunters, who came there with pickaxes. There were about 100 people digging up the beach beyond the cement, the big chunks of cement, and they kept digging.
People started showing up early. At 6 o'clock in the morning, we gave the last clue out at 5 to 6. By 6:30, the beach was covered with people digging like maniacs. Craters everywhere. And the city was not amused and had to send in the bulldozers to fill in all the holes that had been excavated on the beach.
That was shortly before the all-night show ended, and which came as quite a surprise. In fact, it's still surprising.
I was kind of upset to hear that the show in its present format would be going off. And I agree with the previous caller that, you know, without you and, of course, Ryerson, then the show just isn't the same.
Well, no, it won't be the same.
No,
it will be different.
It will be different, yeah, that's for sure.
Without us, yeah.
I wonder, do you know if the Outer Limits will still be on?
Let's have a look here at the schedule.
We got replaced by something called the All Night Showcase, which was basically canned programs without any of us costly live humans in the mix.
Really wasn't the same. We did run, and I believe it was called the All Night Showcase afterwards, which was sort of it was kind of the same sort of thing, but without the Chuck segments. It was really just running the old series and stuff. But it didn't have the response.
I think the show worked because it was so unpretentious. It was sort of like a last bastion of freedom.
Hey, I got a quiz for you. Actually, it's a quiz for the guys at the police stations if you're watching. Guess what drug the host is on?
It was like, for the time that it was, you wanted it to last forever. And forever was that short time.
What the All Night Show did for me was prove that it wasn't just me. That there was in fact an audience out there for this kind of stuff, and there was some sort of zeitgeist that they were tapping into.
The degree to which the All Night Show really left its mark is in the fact that when you look at or you think about it now, it doesn't sound all that peculiar, because so many things have happened since then that would not have happened in quite the same way had it not been for the All Night Show.
One could only hope that they will bring back a show like the All Night TV show. I think people are starving for something made up of real people, embracing the community of the nighttime and all of the people that go with the nighttime.
I feel a personal sense of regret, and I know that I share it with many, that this is going to end soon. I can't believe it.
Well, it's
finally.
Radio and television, to me, are the sources of three essential things. Information, entertainment, and companionship. The companionship factor is what we have eliminated out of the media process.
It was a major high point in my life, and I loved playing the character. But I think the greatest level was to have this sense of communication and community that we enjoyed for that year. And that still goes on.
Let's get that out of here. Well, listen, we did have a winner because you did spot Bruce Dern and Sheldon Nadal. Sheldon, you're watching. You won yourself a trip to North Bay via Air Canada. You have to leave on a Saturday and you have to come back on a Sunday. You can spend overnight, get yourself pissed, or you could spend the whole week there if you really like it. Anyway, you
nice sneakers, Chas. I'm glad to see you're wearing sensible shoes.
Well, thanks, Sheldon. And as a doctor of podiatry, you're a guy who can give that kind of advice.
That's right.
It's 25 years I've had these, and I have taken them off since. Anyway, this is Sheldon Nadal, and Sheldon Nadal was the winner of our very first contest. And what did you win?
It was a trip to North Bay, Chas.
You know, we just gave away great stuff, didn't we?
It would have been great. Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to go.
Oh, well, maybe this time.
Okay.
Actually, you're not going to win anything here because the reason I've actually here is because I have one last all-night show button, which I would like to give away. And through these 25 years, I have hung on to a number of envelopes, unopened, of people who sent in asking for buttons or this, that, and the other thing. So I thought, well, we could have our final contest, and your, as our first contest winner, would be perfect. So reach in here and haul out. We'll see if we can get a phone number, and we'll give somebody a phone call. What's this? Darren Manning. Did Darren give us up? Darren has no phone number. Darren sent his report card, intermediate division grade 7 and 8. Darren, I hope you're doing well.
That's funny, Chas. Sent his report card. Hope he's doing much better than
Dan. Yeah, you get your hand. Yeah, I shouldn't be doing this. What's this? Okay, who's this from? Ooh, dear Chuck, I don't know if you know anything about this. Ooh, well, I think I could read that one later.
Is that lipstick?
Personal? They look personal. Yeah. Wait. Okay. Let's see what we've got here.
Ah, this might be a good one.
It looks like a good one. Hey, you. What would you say? Marge McDonald. Let's open this guy up and see what we've got in here. Marge McDonald. Sorry, it's a souvenir.
Thank you.
Marge McDonald, Center Street, North Bay, Ontario.
That's a coincidence.
And a number. Let me do this. Let's see what we've got here. Hello, could I speak to Marge McDonald, please?
This is Marge.
Marge.
Yes.
Hi, this is Chas Lawther. I'm phoning from Toronto. I used to play Chuck the Security Guard on the All Night Show. I don't know if you remember that.
Yes, of course I remember that. Yes. This is... Who am I speaking with?
Well, you're speaking with Chas Lawther.
This is Chuck?
Well, Chuck, yes.
Oh, my goodness.
I know I'm getting back to you a little late.
Dear Lord, this is 20... My goodness, how are you?
Oh, I'm very well.
My goodness, you got my letter after all.
Well, I did. Actually, we just opened it up now.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, I actually have a button for you, Marge.
You have a button for me.
I do, and I would be thrilled to send it to you. Are you still on Center Street in North Bay?
Yes, I am, as a matter of fact.
Well, excellent.
This is very exciting.
I'm so glad you're still there, and I will put it in the mail along with a picture of myself.
I will.
Okay.
Oh, my goodness, Chuck.
Okay.
Oh, Chuck, this is very wonderful. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. It's good to talk to you, Marge.
Chuck?
Okay.
Chuck, I love you.
Ah, well, I love you too, Marge.
Thank you.
I mean that in a general sense,
that's
of course,
wonderful.
That I... Well,
she was there. I mean, that's what's amazing after 25 years.
It's unbelievable.
It's unbelievable after 25 years, Sheldon. Well, you know, I think probably on that note, it would be good to say goodbye for you and to you, Ryerson, to you, Sheldon,
and
to Leonard, and to everyone who's watching. Hope to see you again in 25 years or even sooner. 25 years.
Good night, Chuck.
Good night, Ryerson.
Good night, Chuck.
Good night, Chuck.
Good night, Chuck.
Good night, Chuck.
Good night, Chuck. Hey, good night, Chuck.
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 Good night, Chuck. Good night, Chuck. Good night, Chuck.
Just yesterday morning, they let me know you were gone. Susan, the plans we made put an end to you. Walked out this morning and I wrote down this song. Now I just don't remember who to send it to. Oh, I've seen fire and dancing rain. I've seen sunny skies that I thought would never end. Lonely times when I could not find my friends. But I always knew that I would see you again. Always knew that I would. See you.